My first guest tonight has one of the toughest jobs in Irish politics. In 2011, the electorate gave his party, I think it's fair to call it, an unmerciful hiding. To tell us where he and Fianna Fáil go from here, will you please welcome Micheál Martin. There must be days when you're glad you're not in government now, when you see Joan there today out in Jobstown. Do you think, rather than me?
Well, opposition can be have its moments as well, you know. I wouldn't have agreed with what happened today, I think.
Yeah.
In our country, I think a democratically elected minister should be able to travel, should have freedom of movement. People who are democratically elected from whatever vantage point, there are democratically elected governments, even if I would have my disagreements with Joan and other people. I don't like what happened today in that sense. I agree with protests and so on, but we need freedom of speech, we need freedom of movement, and that would be my line.
I wasn't suggesting you took any pleasure whatsoever in it, because it sounded like that. Yeah. Listen, you grew up in a political house, a very Fianna Fáil house in Gin Turner's Cross.
I did, yeah, I suppose, in the sense that even though none of them were ever in public representation, my father was a self-taught man. He developed his own politics. His own father would have been in the British Army. He had a very tough life. Both his parents died within a year of each other when he was about 15 to 16. So his three brothers went to join the British Army. His older sister stayed at home to try and keep the thing together. And his younger sister went to an orphanage in Cove. And I think he went through an awful lot. He kind of falsified his name to join the Irish Army. He had a brother who spent time as a prisoner of war in a Changi prison in Singapore, which is a notorious, horrible prison, and he came out of it as stone. But incredibly, they thought he was dead. They were told he was missing in action, and towards the end of the war, his other brother rang him or contacted him to say, "I've just read the newspaper, Philip Martin is coming home." And so they stayed in England. He came out of the army, joined CIA, became a bus driver, and he said, you know, he became a De Valera fan at that time and a Fianna Fáil fan. My mother was more instinctively DNA Fianna Fáil, like her parents were East Cork, Mitchelstown, old IRA, and the grandfather would have been involved in the Knocklang ambush and minding famous IRA leaders in the Ganty Mountains. The grandmother, she died when I was two, she was the matriarch. Mm-hmm. I was reared on stories about her. She was a common man woman. She would have rescued IRA leaders. Some of them would pretend they were mentally unwell, would end up in the asylum in Cork. She was a mental health nurse and would walk them out. They'd hop over the wall to their freedom, that kind of thing. Okay. So I was reared in that.
So you hadn't a chance, really?
Had the chance. Yeah. And the father then played football with Jack Lynch. And I remember when we were kids, the father would say, you know, Jack Lynch would be giving an Ardesh speech. We were all frog marched into the sitting room. And for an hour, the speeches went on for an hour that time. And the father would say, "Isn't he fantastic?" Like, no script or anything like that. No, he had a script. Yeah. He was reading, but the father said, "Brilliant man," and all that kind of thing. So he adored Jack Lynch and so on like that. So, yeah, that was the orientation.
Yeah.
And then I never thought I was going to be a politician. Like, there was never any ambition or anything like that.
Okay, but when you went into college, you got in UCC, you got involved in politics.
I got involved in the Fianna Fáil Cumann. At the time, Northern Ireland was a huge issue. Hunger strikes, all that kind of thing. And I would have had a kind of a Republican perspective on life at that time. I went up to the North with a couple of young colleagues at the time to try and find out more about it. We met unionists, we met Sinn Féin people, we met SDLP, we met everybody, social workers, to try and understand it. That had a big influence on me.
And when you say a Republican perspective, what kind would it have been within the spectrum?
It was a Fianna Fáil Republican perspective, United Ireland. But I wouldn't have understood the complexities of it, to be frank with you, at the time. And I remember sitting in a young unionist's house when I went on that trip, and he said to me, "How would you like it," he said, "if your uncle was shot dead just because of the uniform he's wearing? You know, he's my uncle, he's my flesh and blood." And that brought a new dimension, because down in the Republic at the time, you know, there was this idea that sort of Brits out and all that kind of thing, and it was too simplistic at the time. And it took a lot of learning in the Republic to understand the complexities of Northern Ireland at that time. And I maintained a lifelong interest in it. And I would have to say originally that was a catalyst for me getting involved in politics. I also got involved in student union politics towards the end. I met my wife Mary in UCC. in the Fianna Fáil Common, a bit sad, but that's right, where we met. Yeah. It took a while for us to go out with each other. And
were you badgering her, or was she chasing you?
Well, actually,
I'm guessing it was you chasing her.
You know, the usual
her.
Thing when, you know, we're such great friends.
You mean she just saw you as a friend?
We both saw each other as friends, yeah. And that kind of thing. And then the secretary of the Common, who was a bit more confident with women, mm-hmm. we were canvassing one night, it was the time of the three elections in the 80s, and he said to me, you know something, she's kind of a bit of an all right kind of thing, and all that kind of stuff. And I moved then fairly quickly, because your man would have been in before. Okay, <yeah. laughs> had to move then.
You needed the sport.
And then I stayed on an extra year in college, because it was during the dip year that I kind of fell in love. And got, you know, yeah. So I said I'd do a master's degree to hang around a bit, and got elected to the Students' Union at the time as well. And that really, I mean, Students' Union were kind of mad places at the time, because you'd spend all night at meetings having debates about everything and anything. And in a way, I suppose that helped to formulate your thinking processes and so on like that. And I kind of enjoy that for the year that was in it, you know.
Yeah.
And
listen, you talk about growing up, your house was a political house, but obviously not in the sense that your own household is now. Simon Coveney was here a few weeks ago, and obviously from Cork as well, and you know, spends a lot of time away from home. And you know, we hear a lot about how the Dáil isn't family friendly for women. But he was very frank about the fact that he has made huge sacrifices. Now, his kids are a lot younger than yours are, but you were in politics at a time when your kids were a lot younger. Do you make a huge sacrifice in terms of the family and on missing out on things and stuff like that?
You do. I can remember when Micheál, so my oldest son, he was the firstborn, obviously he was the youngest. And when I got appointed to the front bench that time in opposition, in around, I think, 94, you know, he was, as a young one-year-old or whatever, he every time he saw the suit going on, he'd reach for the suit to pull it off. He knew what that meant, you know. You were going off to work. But that said, they're interested in politics as well. It is a huge sacrifice. You were away a lot, but it's an interesting life as well. And I was lucky that Mary was in politics as well. When she left college, she actually got a job as a national youth officer, independent of me. I wasn't even that significant in
no
the party at the time.
There, right.
But she got there herself on her own merit and all of that. So she knew politics, and she knew about life in Dublin, and the carry on and the non-carry on and so on like that. So I think that I was very fortunate and very, very lucky that Mary had instinctive knowledge of politics. And
when you say
looked out for me
life in Dublin,
So
how much time are you up in Dublin on a normal kind of week?
Well, since I became leader now, I'd be up much more. I mean, I could be four or five nights some weeks. Average TD might be three nights or two nights in Dublin, depending. You might go down on a Thursday night. I'm also travelling around the countryside, obviously, in terms of trying to renew the party in different areas. Local elections for 12 months, I would have been in every parish, literally across the country.
It strikes me that the kind of... it seems the default position for a lot of guys when they're up in Dublin during the week and that is that you kind of, you know, you work hard, I'm sure, and round off the day with a few points and that kind of thing. You wouldn't have the image of being a fellow who's like the last out of the bar or anything, no?
Not quite. But like I do enjoy a pint, you know, nothing like, and you know, a pint of Murphy's in West Cork would be my idyllic sort of scene. Midweek it's difficult, I find, you know, I would have an odd pint, but you just don't have time for it, and particularly in my present position, you're on the move all the time.
Okay.
You don't perform as well the following morning if one is honest about it.
Totally.
So I tend not to midweek, maybe around Christmas time and things like that. Yes, but beyond that, no, you wouldn't have that opportunity.
Right. Listen, I know this is something that you don't like to really talk about. I don't want to talk about it directly, but I suppose I'm interested in the effect it has on you and your character as a person. You lost not one, but your family lost two children, which must be beyond devastating for a family. And I know that, you know, in deference to your family, you don't like to talk about it too much. Can I ask you about, though, how does that change you and how does it change your perspective on stuff?
That's a difficult question. I'm not sure. In some sense, I mean, it's a devastating thing to happen to any family. It's just absolutely devastating. And there is no magic wand. You know, when Rory died in 1999, he was 5 weeks old. It was a cot death on that occasion. And we were devastated. The children keep you going. Micheál and Ava at the time were our source. You have to get up the next morning and carry on, and that's it in many respects. And then we never expected what happened 4 years ago when Lena died. She was the light of our life. She was a beautiful young daughter. And it had a devastating impact on us. And I think what it does change your perspective on life in the sense that you're more detached from crisis. And what I mean detached, what I mean is you don't allow other things to bother you as much, perhaps, or that you can see things clearer for not being the catastrophes that others think they are. I mean, when you go through that, other stuff can be dealt with in terms of politics or whatever. And I remember having that chat with Brian Lenihan during the crisis, when we both said, to a certain extent, we were both going through different traumas at that time, with Lena, my case, and his diagnosis. And we kind of could see other things with a bit more clarity, if that makes any sense.
It makes complete sense. Yeah.
And we were able to kind of make decisions in a way that was almost non-political and non-party political.
For a greater good. Listen, so we come on to politics. I want to ask you about on Wednesday. It was an extraordinary day in the Dáil. I thought a lot of people made a lot of fantastic speeches. You spoke with great passion and great conviction about Micheál, about Sinn Féin, and all that kind of thing. This is something you've been involved in for a while, the Micheál case, isn't it?
Yeah, I would have met Micheál 2 years ago in November 2012, and she came to see me because she wanted to make me aware about what was happening in her case, and she went through everything with me. And she was concerned at the time in terms of how the prosecution service might treat it. She felt there was very sensitive people involved in her case and that it may never see the light of day. I said to her, I can't do anything once it's in the process, but we will make people aware that we're knowledgeable about it and that we're aware of your situation. Years back, I would have been involved in the inquiry into the abuse in our industrial schools, and I would have stopped the Ferns inquiry into abuse in the Ferns diocese, child sexual abuse there. So I had some experience of meeting victims of sexual abuse. Maria's story was a harrowing story, because abuse really impacts on a person's life, has the potential to destroy a person's life, to start a person's life. And her story was truly shocking. And this story is about that in the first instance. It's about a young girl who was abused. And the most important thing for any person who has been abused is to believe the person, because every time it's denied, you re-traumatize the person. I can remember when the late Christine Buckley of Golden Bridge, when I met her at the time, she had been through a lot since the documentary Dear Daughter. She had met all sorts of people and got nowhere. And she just looked me in the eye and says, Micheál, will you tell me you believe me? And it was exactly the same with Micheál, you know. And that affirmation is important, because that's the beginning, I think, of healing and the beginning of people coming to terms with it and having their say and trying to bring some closure to it.
I suppose one thing that struck me when I saw you speak with such conviction and such passion and stuff is that maybe the reason we were noticing it so much is that sometimes I wonder if you can tend to not be able to have that conviction, because in a sense a lot of the big issues of the day, property tax or water charge, austerity in general, are you a bit compromised on all those things because basically ye signed us up for them? So is it difficult to get stuck in on those kind of populist issues that so many people are making such capital out of?
Yeah, on some of the issues, yes, of course, in terms of issues that were in the in the four-year plan. But on other issues, you know, take the medical cards. I had no difficulty in conviction there. I hated the fact that young kids with discretionary medical cards were losing them through a new system or a bureaucratic system. And we kept telling the government for 18 months before they suddenly copped on after the local elections that this was real. Children who had them for 4 or 5 years because of life-limiting conditions or life-threatening conditions. Education makes me passionate. I suppose, going back to my father, the one thing my father and mother gave me was an education. That was their passion. That was their fundamental objective. They wanted to get us to college. They wanted to get us to have an education that they never had. We'd have been the first in our family to complete second level, never mind go to university. And that was a big thing for them. And that has stayed with me. If I have one driving passion in politics, is that every child gets a chance to fulfil his or her potential.
Okay,
that's what drives me.
Can I ask you, just in a nutshell, you must have a lot of regrets about your political career, your career in government. Just one thing. What's your biggest single regret when you look back on maybe your last two periods in government?
I think the biggest regret would be not standing out against the herd more often. And I think that's something we should learn from the collapse. Not to be afraid to speak out when 90% are going in
one
direction.
Were you afraid to speak out?
I wasn't afraid, but probably should have spoken out on a number of occasions in terms of the lowering of tax too much. And at that time, you know, that was one of the biggest issues in terms of the fiscal thing. And some other issues are going along with the consensus. And I think for too much in Irish politics, a lot of us go along with the consensus. And that's something I have learned from it. And that I would hope to think that into the future we'll stand up.
Now, looking into the future, the post that Fianna Fáil kind of apocalypse has left us with a strange political landscape. Like, we've more independents than we've ever had. They're from across the whole spectrum. Sinn Féin is apparently the biggest party in the country now, but no one's willing to go into coalition with them. Fianna Fáil doesn't appear to be kind of making that resurgence as fast as he'd like to be doing. There's a real fear, isn't there, that after the next election, we could be looking at a fairly chaotic landscape. It could be difficult to form a government, could it?
It will be very difficult, I think, to form a government after the next election. I think we need to be careful too. You know, I can remember before the last general election, I think it was 6 months before, the Labour Party were 33%, I think, in one poll, and they came back to 19. So there's a lot of volatility over at the moment. Understandable, like, people are finding it hard. People, a lot of families have suffered a lot. Incomes have dropped, people have lost jobs, people have emigrated and so on. So I think it's very understandable where we are right now. I think there's a challenge to all of us, and I think we have to, it's about policies and issues first and foremost. I'm not as pessimistic as some might be about what will happen after a general election. I do trust the Irish people. I think we must trust democracy and the ballot
box. Do you think you'll be in government? I mean, you infamously said that you were aiming to be Taoiseach. Mm-hmm. I'd say you probably calmed down a bit about that. But do you see yourself in the next government?
Well, what's important is, I think anyone who's a leader of a party must aspire I want to get there. And I want to get there for the sake of getting there, but I want to do certain things.
Yeah. Realistically, do you think you'll be part of the next government?
I think we have as good a chance as anybody else at this stage. If you look at what's happening, there's about four blocks. In or about 20%, plus or minus. There's Fianna Fáil, there's Fine Gael, there's Sinn Féin, and there's the big block of independents. And so that, it's more like European politics at the moment, you know, in terms of a lot of parties in Europe who are in government are on 24%, for example. And you might find this strange, even in the group that we're a member of in Europe, we actually would have had the highest percentage in the local elections of any of our European colleagues, right?
Okay.
So they're coming, you did very well, you know, kind of thing. Well, not by our historic standards did we do well. So I think politics has changed, and I think 2011 was a watershed. I was never under any illusion, but it would be a long journey back, you know?
Okay.
And it will be. But we are making progress, and we've got, thanks be to God, out of the local elections, there's a new generation of younger people have come in now, and I can see a future. That I didn't see before the local elections because of the extra generation of young people that are in there, you know.
Thank you very much. Micheál Martin, ladies and gentlemen.